Today, I'm interviewing a very interesting patient of mine, Toby Threadgill.
He is an elite caliber athlete who travels the globe teaching classical Japanese martial arts. He is the only non-Japanese in the world to currently hold ultimate authority over one of the old samurai-era martial arts schools. His schedule can be grueling, with him traveling over 130,000 miles a year and teaching 8-hour days, 10 days straight. He also teaches international law enforcement, as well as members of our international security infrastructure. At the age of 54, he approached me for help in maintaining his physical prowess.
I want to ask you, what was it that initially brought you to come to our clinic here?
Well, when I was in my 30s, and particularly when I was doing Thai boxing, I started noticing certain health-related issues that I couldn't wrap my head around. One of the most serious problems I had was I started losing the ability to perspire or sweat. And this led me to getting overheated in one training session in the summertime when it was really, really hot, and I became sort of delirious and collapsed, and an old boxing coach in the gym recognized what had happened to me, and they poured ice water all over me and got me cooled off, and he told me I needed to go to the doctor, something was wrong with me. And because I would stay totally dry even when it was 100 plus degrees, and I was fighting this what amounted to a non-air-conditioned concrete box. I don't know how hot it would get in the ring where I was fighting, but it was just swelteringly hot, and I just collapse. And so I went to a doctor, and they told me I had a condition called anhydrosis, and did a bunch of tests on me, and led me to believe that it was genetically. It was related to genetics, and that there wasn't anything to do about it. And they did a bunch of tests and stuff and said, oh, this is what the deal is, and it's dangerous, you need to be careful, yada, yada, yada. And then there were other things. I started having arthritic-like symptoms. My joints were hurting all the time. And then I started losing muscle mass and strength. And no matter amount of training, weightlifting or whatever, it seemed to help. I was just getting weaker and weaker and weaker, and I would go to the doctors and they would say, oh, you're just getting old. You know, kind of pat you on the head and say, welcome to middle age and this and that, and you know, you're just getting old. And it was getting worse and worse and worse. And I became really frustrated because I thought, I'm going to have to stop teaching. I was in so much pain and I was losing so much muscle tone that I couldn't really keep doing what I was doing. And around that time, just accidentally out of the blue, this guy named Cyrus Peikari, Facebook friends me, and says he used to train with me. And then I honestly didn't remember you. I couldn't place a face with a name. But so many people went through the SMU Martial Arts Club.
Sure, I was just a college student.
Yeah, just a college student, and so I said, okay. And then I went and looked at your website, or your Facebook page, and all of a sudden it said you were a doctor, and I'm like going, you know, and had your credentials as a doctor, and I'm like, wow, I don't remember this guy. And then if you remember, I came to SMU to teach seminar, and you looked at me, and I told you all the things I was dealing with, and you said, I think I know what this is. And that's how it all started. So you're the one that diagnosed my hypothyroidism. And nobody else, none of my other doctors got it. Not another doctor even suggested hypothyroidism is an issue.
I'm like that old black boxing coach, right?
Yeah, I mean,
there's a lot to that.
Well, there is.
Those guys know.
Well, I'll be honest with you. What amazed me is that I'd had all these blood tests done and gone to all these doctors for all these years, and had constantly complained about what was bothering me, and nobody got it. Nobody even brought up the possibility of hypothyroidism. And you looked at me, and within 10 minutes, he said, "I think I know what's wrong with you." And the fact that you were right, that blew my mind. Because as soon as I got on the thyroid replacement, hormone replacement, within, I'm not exaggerating, within 2 days I felt different. Within a week, I felt like a new human being. And then 7 weeks later, I was building muscle again. My joints were no longer hurting the way they were. And then I think a year later, the difference was dramatic.
So yeah. you really had this condition for at least 20 years.
Yeah, evidently it was started 20 years ago in my 30s.
And got worse probably.
And got worse and worse and worse. And it, you know, it's funny, I can think back to the things that I thought were just nagging issues. But it was after I turned 50 that I felt like everything just kind of fell off a cliff. It was a slow decline up till maybe 51, something like that. And then all of a sudden, around 51, it became critical because it's just like everything fell apart altogether. Drastic changes in my strength and my endurance and all that sort of stuff. And I just couldn't believe it was just age-related. But everybody was saying, oh, it's just getting old. Oh, then getting old sucks. But I didn't know it didn't suck as bad as it was sucking for me because it wasn't just age-related.
I can only imagine how frustrating that might be, knowing that something's wrong but not...
Well, knowing that something's wrong and then trying to deal with the fact that nobody either knows what's wrong or... They're just saying there's nothing you can do about it. And I didn't feel old. I was 51 years old, but I didn't feel old. And the things that I was experiencing were really devastating. As a professional martial artist, it's like one of my friends, I have a very good massage therapist, you know, body alignment guy. And he's the one that's, you know, really hammered home one day. He said, you're a professional athlete. Do you realize that? And he said, you know, when you're an advertising photographer, you took care of your cameras, right? You maintained all your equipment. I'm like, yeah. And he says, but you're a professional athlete. You're not maintaining your equipment. You really need to maintain your body because, he said, this is what you do for a living. It's your machine that allows you to make your living. You better take care of it. But to have that said, and then have another doctor say, basically there's nothing we can do to take care of your machine. That's very frustrating. And no matter what I seemed to do, nothing really helped. If I tried exercising, I had home gym stuff, and I would try exercising, and instead of me building muscle or getting stronger, my joints would just hurt more, and every time I tried to train harder, it just meant that I was straining. I ended up pulling muscles and stuff like that, straining muscles and hurting my joints. So I didn't know what to do. I was so frustrated, but I had no pathway forward. Not until I met you, and then all of a sudden, the diagnosis and your explanation of what was going on with me physiologically gave me hope that this could be turned around. And then, like I said, 6 months to a year later, I was a totally new person. I felt like I was in my 30s again.
You know, a lot of people may hear that. They may have someone say, well, I think I know what's wrong with you. But it's a huge leap of faith to actually come in.
Well,
and it's expensive, too.
It is. It's
plus your travel.
Yeah.
You have to travel.
I travel. I fly all the way from Colorado here to see you. But... and it is expensive, but what's your health worth? I hear people say it all the time. It's like, yeah, you don't appreciate your health until you don't have it anymore. So it's real easy to make excuses or to view it as something that's too expensive. But when you lose it, you'll spend anything to get it back. Yeah, taking care of my machine basically is a big deal.
Before you go, so what's next for you in life? Simple question.
Well, I don't know. I'm gonna keep training and teaching as long as I can. I have a responsibility to pass the art that's entrusted to me. I'm a temporary custodian. I don't own this. This tradition is something that's been passed down through generations. I'm a temporary custodian of the art. I have to pass it forward to somebody that is also going to take as good a care of it or better care of it than I did. That's my responsibility. That was my teacher's responsibility and going all the way back. So I have to find people that can take the art forward and then select one person to lead the whole school into the next generation. And until that's done, until I have that all sorted, I'm going to continue to teach and do what I'm doing now. After that, I have no idea. I love to travel, and so I hope I always travel, and I hope I can maintain my health as long as possible. I'm as physically active as I am, and as much as I enjoy travel, I'm going to be on top of my health. I get a blood test all the time. I stay on top of it, and I'm obviously coming to see you every 3 or 4 months, fly down from Colorado, because you have to stay on top of it. It's my responsibility to make sure that I can maintain my health as long as possible, and I have a partner now that I trust to help me to do that, and it's worth it. So,
well, thank you. That's all I've got.
Well, thank you. I mean, the difference you've made in my life has been dramatic, so I owe you a lot.
Oh, you're very kind.